Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome, and thanks for being here. I know this is the last day of the conference, but so happy to see that the room is still full. I'd also like to welcome our web audience as well, and if you're live tweeting, please use hashtag GPF16 if you haven't already. My name is Anmei Chung, and I am the Director of Strategic Partnerships at the Mozilla Foundation, and I have spent the majority of my work life actually in philanthropy. Was at the Mott Foundation, the MacArthur Foundation before this, so very much understand the importance of having philanthropy be involved in these initiatives to really create sustainability and systems of growth. So, as you know, our session is titled The Job Challenges and explores what I think a lot of us are looking at in the philanthropic world, and it's really thinking about how to increase economic opportunity as well as upward mobility. And this morning's session is really about, you know, unpacking what the internet and the 21st century skills can do. We're going to spend a good part of the morning asking questions of this esteemed panel, and there will be hopefully back and forth conversation amongst them. And we will open it up for Q&A for the rest of you around 10 o'clock. So listen carefully. Think about questions that you want to ask these guys, ones that can stump them and get them thinking in the same way they will get you thinking as well. So the first thing I want to do is actually give you a few facts about what we're going to talk about. And the good news is, and good for Mozilla in particular, that as the internet expands, there are a lot more people emerging in economies and experiencing social mobility for the first time. And the internet has been able to make that possible. And like the printing press and like the automobile, it is one of these inventions that are definitely catapulting people who have been in disenfranchised regions to the middle class, which is an aspiration for many. People can produce and make in ways that they couldn't before. They can share it in real time. They can make themselves open and vulnerable in ways and powerful that they couldn't do otherwise. And entrepreneurs can connect with capital and markets around the world in a flash these days. And job seekers have the opportunity to really find the kinds of jobs that they've been looking for worldwide, and it doesn't mean that they have to be physically there. It doesn't end there, though. And I think this is what this panel is about. It's the internet is not just about booming economy, but it is about transforming it. So we've got micro enterprises that are growing, self-employment. The nature of work is changing. And what we say at Mozilla often is that in a few years, all jobs will be digital in some way, shape, or form. So it's critical that we provide the skills that are needed to be able to read, write, and participate on the web. I think the other big opportunity here with the internet is that it can increase access and equity for disenfranchised people in a way that was not possible. On the other hand, it can actually widen that gap too as well, and I think that's something we really need to be thoughtful about. So with these opportunities, we know that the challenges are still huge with jobs across the world. And the World Bank, for example, data is pretty sobering. In one-third of the world's 1.8 billion youth, right, are either unemployed or that are not involved in any sort of training or education programs at all. And over the next 10 years or so, about 1 billion of them will enter the job market, and half of them will get jobs that currently exist. We still don't have jobs created yet for the other, over 6 million people who need jobs, and we have to just keep up as well. So what can we do to leverage the tools that we have, the internet and the 21st century skills? Some of this is already occurring to some extent. There's little pockets of communities that are growing. There's microenterprises that are growing. The idea of using free and open source software, which is a big part of what Mozilla does, is still untapped, and there's an opportunity there. But these are still pockets, little pockets and isolations of great stories, but what does it mean to really scale and sustain? So today, we have this panel who clearly have done a lot of great work in this area. I'm just getting to know them, and just from what I've read thus far in terms of their accomplishments, I am incredibly humbled and actually looking very forward to learning from these folks. They are people who are on the cutting edge of putting solutions in place. They are leading nonprofits and social ventures, and clearly are the leaders moving forward from here. So we have Karan, who is the co-founder and partner of Opportunity at Work. Karan is focused on transforming the U.S. labor market to increase upward mobility. Early in his career, if you can imagine, that must have been when you were like 12, I think, he co-founded the Global Agri-Development Company, which is an agri-food business in sub-Saharan Africa. He also co-founded the West Africa Vocational Education, an organization that looks at unemployment in Nigeria. And he was named one of Forbes' 30 Under 30 Social Entrepreneurs and is selected as a New Voices Fellow at the Aspen Institute. So you must have started when you were like 10, based on that. So, and we have Josh, who is the CEO of KCB Group. It's the largest bank in East Africa, which serves about 8 million people in Kenya. 8 million people in Kenya, Tanzania, South Sudan, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, and Ethiopia. He believes it's important to enable financial services for many customers as possible, and has done this through mobile devices. He was also named among the top 100 youngest and influential economic leaders in Africa by the Institute of Choiseul. So another great accomplishment. And then we have Shai on my left here, who is the president of the University of the People. It's the world's first nonprofit tuition-free accredited online university, which is quite impressive in itself. And for those of you who haven't seen his TED Talk, I encourage you to get online and see his TED Talk on this. It's definitely inspirational. Before he founded the University of the People, he directed KIT e-learning, the first online university in Europe, which I think is how he was able to do the University of the People. And he also was named Fast Company's 100 Most Creative People in Business and selected by the Huffington Post as the ultimate game changer in education. That's quite a title in itself. So why don't we get started on the Q&A right now, and I'm going to throw out a question, and we'll start with Karan, and then ask the other panelists to jump in, and feel free to jump in and have a dialogue with Karan about this. Okay. The first question is, what role can the employers themselves play in closing the jobs gap?
Thanks, Anne May, and it's great to be here with all of you. So I think it's an extremely pertinent question because as we view the jobs market, and we view it not as jobs programs, but really as a market, there is a huge role for employers to play. And I'll come to it, but I want to maybe drill down a little bit on what I just said on the jobs market in how we think about this. So why do we think about this as a market as opposed to a program? So first of all, it's in the US alone, it's an $8.5 trillion market, our labor market. It's our biggest market, but it is dysfunctional. It does not work well for, we approximate about half the labor force, about 80 million people just here. And I think this is true globally. And every single market failure you can think of manifests itself in the jobs market. And this matters because as an individual, a job seeker, someone trying to make it, all the investments you have made yourself or society has made in you, they get realized in the jobs market, or they get inhibited by the jobs market. Think about all the investment in primary education, secondary education, tertiary education, on-the-job training, learning, however you get it. To work, learn, and earn to your full potential requires a labor market that is inclusive to be able to do it. So if we took that frame of why that matters, and it matters because it's an issue of individual dignity, right? Joblessness, involuntary joblessness, research shows, can have as great an impact as things like losing a limb or other really catastrophic events for individuals. So these are issues fundamentally of sort of individual dignity and self-reliance, which matter. And taking the frame of, okay, so now what would it take for our labor market, where on one side you've got employers, not just here in the US, but across the world, complaining that they need more talent all the time. Barrier to scale, human capital. It's true in Nigeria, it's true here, it's true in Ghana, it's true everywhere. And on the other side, you've got all these people locked out of those jobs. What would it take to do it? And I would argue the first step starts with employers. So today, and how do you make employers to hiring based on ability and demonstration of skill, not based on pedigree? Let me give you an example. In the US, there's data that shows in 2014, Burning Glass data, that 65% of job descriptions for an administrative assistant required a four-year degree. One in five administrative assistants today have a four-year degree. So if you are an administrative assistant in that job today and you see a job opening and you want to go get that job and you can do it, you have the skill, you have the aptitude, you have the motivation to do it, you will not pass the screen to get that job. So how do we make hiring based on demonstration of ability, not based on pedigree? And that comes from the employer side, the demand side of this market. Because if you went through training, for example, and you didn't have the measures that employers hire for, and you didn't get that job, was the training bad? Or was the screening bad? Or did you not learn enough? Who knows today? And these proxies, they are used by employers for good measure. In the world 15 years ago, where we didn't have information and we didn't have the technology we have today, those were measures you had to use because you cannot interview 2,000 people, 3,000 people to figure it out. You can use proxies. But today, we focus a lot on IT jobs of all categories. If you want to get somebody to create a website for you, would you rather see the portfolio of their work, a website they've built, which you can easily do today, or would you look for some certification or a degree? So there is technology that can help us address this problem. And so unlocking that side of the market can unleash massive potential in learning, innovation throughout. Because now if you know as an individual, this is something that the job seeker, that the employer is looking for, that I can actually demonstrate. And then if I go learn it, however I learn it online, I learn it from my community, I learn it in college, I learn it wherever, I can showcase that. You now have a pathway to say, if I do X, I will learn Y, and I can land job Z. But if the job description says, you have had to have done this for the last 7 years of your life, the one technology we don't yet have is time machines. So you cannot actually rewind that 7 years to go do what it takes, and you cannot spend the next 7 years of your life doing those things to go get that. The second reason why it matters is because we spend a lot of time thinking about financing. The funding, be it philanthropic, be it public sector, whatever it is, of training and education, and training, I would say, vocational ed, things like that, is a drop in the ocean compared to what employers spend on wages. It's a drop in the ocean. So employers have capital on their balance sheet that they are looking to invest in human capital. How do you unlock that? And to unlock it, you've got to understand the demand side of the market, what employers are looking for. You've got to have the right screens to be able to do it. And then irrespective of the learning, you can add value to it. And if you unlock that potential, it touches everybody's life who got that job, but it creates enormous value for our entire economic system and for employers themselves. I would argue the greatest driver of growth will come from Now, optimizing of human capital. We've spent a lot of time optimizing invested capital. Plant, property, equipment, what do you depreciate, what do you amortize, automation, things like that. But if we can figure out how to optimize empty car seats with Uber or empty bedrooms with Airbnb, imagine the value that we can create by optimizing the potential that exists in people. And I would argue it starts from the employer side of the equation.
Thank you very much. And I will add on just, especially in most markets where we operate ourselves in Africa, in the last 10 years, there's been a major revolution, especially digital revolution. Mobile has transformed the way we see services and knowledge. So there has to be a shift in orientation, the way employers look at resources. Just give you some kind of examples. You know, 10 years ago, you know, elements like mobile money transfer and mobile money itself did not exist a lot in terms of the way businesses were operating. So the kind of skills that we needed before as employers for our own businesses were actually quite static. And so the reason why the investment must be made by employers today is that they're shifting the kind of transformation they're looking in terms of the resource. Part of it is skilling that needs to be done and upskilling. We see new opportunities actually creating new markets, and especially in the markets where we see in the continent. We see the role of mobile as a real catalyst of opening up new opportunities. Most of you have heard about M-Pesa, for instance, KCB M-Pesa, M-Copa. What this does is start to reimagine new niches in the market that addresses not just skills, but also addresses the real issue about job challenges that we're facing today. So, and then the second aspect is about the micro and small enterprises. Because those skills as we build, I mean, if you look at the UN report of 2014, over 250 million people in Africa today by the age of 15 to 24. In East Africa alone, 2.5 million people come to the job market every year. And therefore, globally, we need to create between 600, 700 million jobs in the next 15 years by 2030. And a lot of that will be the skills available. I see a different parallelism myself in the environment you're living today. That whereas in the last century, we are focusing on skills that were static, the 21st century skills are very dynamic. That they want to be on land, on increasing on what we have today as a business. And therefore, I think it's both a key issue for employers to invest in terms of their resources as well as the resources and jobs and employees who are coming to job markets. I want to agree fully that the employers can't sit behind and expect a transformation in terms of the job market without investing.
So I hope that you forgive me, but I look at things slightly different. There is higher education. And people recently come and say higher education does not deliver. It doesn't prepare people for the job market. As such, we should ignore the higher education and move to training people to be able to do the job. Now, I think that we mix two things. The role of higher education is to create well-rounded people who have critical thinking, who have knowledge of the world, knowledge of the history, knows a lot. These people should also be prepared for the job market. The fact that higher education, or most of it, do not prepare people for the job market does not mean that we should neglect higher education. We should do both. We want people to be educated. That's the future of the world. Yes, there is a problem of accessibility and affordability. It can be solved. Actually, the internet is a great way to solve these issues, and we should do it. But at the same time, we should make sure that when people study, they not only study theoretical things, but study things that will prepare them for the job market. And it's not either or, because the either or actually takes us back to many, many years ago, where some people were qualified for higher education, and some people were qualified for vocational training. And those who were qualified for vocational training, were not qualified to study in higher education. These days are over. We should be able to give them both. Actually, the internet, and the reason we can't do both right now is because higher education is so expensive. But think about it. Higher education can cost a fraction of what it costs right now. Actually, we at the University of the People do that. It costs $4,000 for a full BA degree over four as many years that they study. So it can be affordable. It can be accessible because, as we all know, the internet has no limits of seats. But at the same time, prepare students for the job market and gain both of them together. Have people with a broad knowledge, well-rounded students, and at the same time, make them prepare to the job market.
So thank you all for those brief but I think very specific things about what you all care about. And a follow-up question for you all that involves the pieces that you know the most about is that you really have talked a lot about human capital and the need to invest in human capital. And with the work that you're doing, what is it going to take to invest in this human capital? And particularly for those who are disfranchised, because the things that you're talking about sound very, I don't think anyone would disagree on a high level that yes, we need to do that, but what does that look like practically?
Anyone? Well, I don't think it should take much. The internet these days are going very wide and it will continue to reach more and more people around the world. These people can get the education that they need without a lot of money. As I mentioned before, it cost $4,000 with us to get a full BA degree. Most people in the world can afford this amount, even in remote areas. By the way, we offer scholarships for those who cannot afford it. But it doesn't have to cost much. And the internet now is going a long way. Now, we do not use the most sophisticated technology that is available there. We don't use video, we don't use audio. We make sure that any internet connection you have, you can study with us. As such, you can study with a laptop, you can study with your cell phone, with any kind of connectivity that you have to study with us. And therefore, it doesn't cost a lot, it doesn't require a lot of investment, and you can bring great education to the most remote areas of the world.
Well, I think we've seen dramatic shifts. If I look at the role, especially in Africa, what you find most is the mobile shift in terms of delivering of information. So it's kind of made the world flat. It doesn't really matter which part you are. If you have access, and most countries generally, I mean, in East Africa, you generally have 98 to 99% access on mobile penetration. And you can deliver content directly, education content, to any single person that has a mobile connection. And it doesn't have to be the most sophisticated phones. It's not a smartphone you require. So that is already happening in the market, actually, in terms of who can access that information. And it doesn't have to be not just higher level. We see that happening from the very basic, so primary level of education, secondary levels. I think the more aspect is more to coordinate the kind of content being delivered and the policy mechanism. You know, if you look at many years ago, and I'll give you a true story, you had 10 years ago, you had kids in some parts of, like in Kenya, for instance, or in the country, who had not seen the kind of exams until the exam day. They had no idea what the exams looked like, because maybe they were so far removed from the center. And yet they're supposed to sit for the same examination like the colleagues. And what digital revolution has done today is that at a snapshot of a click of a button today, they have the same amount of information and access. In my view, I see this as a very strategic democratization of access of education. So that's already uplifting the platforms for every single child we have in the continent.
So to add to it, there are three things we're talking about. One is information problems. And I think technology is the most efficient way to address those information problems, right? What you're mentioning on a mobile phone, can I get information of, what, and but also information of what do I need to do, what do I need to learn, and if I made that investment, where will it take me, right? So I, as an individual, I'm empowered with the information and the understanding of the pathway. Then I think there are models of, okay, so you have that information, what does financing look like to then access it? And that can become cheaper and cheaper, right, of financing learning services that you need. But what are financing models that are sustainable, right? Pay for success, tied to employers, for example, or ways for people to invest in their own learning in a pay it forward way. How do we think about that? And then if you think about then disenfranchised communities, there's a huge role for offline support services to play in those places. It matters. It matters of how are you going to get the set of support services, be it some form of mentoring, which some of it can be online, some of it is offline, some form of, okay, even in the work we do in communities here, how do you mobilize communities? Because for someone to go attend even an accelerated program, another program, they need help with childcare, they need help with transportation to get to wherever they need to get to, they need help with, when things get tough, right? Like, who is it that's going to help you get there? And there's a huge role for those set of services to play, but they can be, the return on that can be more efficient with the information, financing, and then how do you mobilize it, to Joshua's point, around a coordinated set of initiatives? So I'll give you an example. There's a young woman by the name of Lashana Lewis, born in St. Louis, in the US. She went through her education, then started a computer science degree to learn computer science. Then life got in the way. She had to drop out. And then she wanted to do IT jobs. That was her passion, that was her interest. Applied, couldn't get in anywhere. So for 10 years, she was a bus driver there. Now, after that, through technology, there was an organization called LaunchCode that said, okay, I'm giving you the information that if you can demonstrate this skill, this is the information thing, right? If you can demonstrate this skill, we can help you get placed into a job. And then there was low-cost learning. They said, okay, if you don't have all of it, here's an online-offline model, very low-cost, that you can get access to. You find the financing to do it. And then the third piece around support services of there was Coder Girl meetup groups that she was part of. There was a support system, a mentoring network that existed that they tapped into, St. Louis, which is what civic organizations did. It's not that a technology organization would do that, right? It's a civic institution that plays that role, but it was coordinated, right, to do it, and they placed her at MasterCard. Now she's a systems engineer there. So I think there is a technology thing, there's a financing thing, but there is a role of sort of communities and the support services. The question is, how do you thread all of that in very well-defined interfaces with each other?
Thank you. That's very helpful thinking. Is like, there's a lot of systems approach, I think, responses coming out of what you all are talking about. And I want to dig a little bit deeper, because thinking about this in the global context, there are a lot of cultural barriers, I think, that need to be crossed in terms of gaining access and equity, particularly for women and girls, which I think has been a theme of this. And would like to hear from you all, like, how do we, what do we need to do to open up those opportunities for members of communities that may not be able to access it because of cultural and other reasons?
Well, I think that online setting is the perfect place to overcome cultural differences. It's challenging. We have, at the University of the People, we have students from 180 countries all over the world, all of them sitting in classes of 20. Every time a student takes a class, we put him, her, in a class of 20 students from 20 different countries. BA is 40 courses, 40 times we mix them. 20 new students, 20 new countries every time. So you can expose them to different cultures, and you want to do that because you want people to become part of the global village, part of the global market, because they're planning on working them, and you want to open them to other ways of thoughts. We believe that there is a different or even more important side benefit. We can call it side benefit. We believe it's the most important thing, because when you put people from hostile cultures, you actually teach them that those that consider to be their enemies outside of the class are tend to be the closest to them in terms of culture. So think about Indian and Pakistani, Israelis and Arab, Turks and Greek, you know, they hate each other, right? They're so close to each other when you look from the outside. And you actually open their minds to show them that they are They are similar. So I believe that when you online is a great way to bring people together. Now, it doesn't come without difficulties. There are difficulties. Because just think about something very trivial. You have a classroom and you have people talking in the class. Americans talk much more than Japanese, for example, and they dominate the class. How do you make the American be less loud and make the Eastern Asian a little bit more loud? It's something that takes time. Teaching people that you have to talk, because if you don't talk, we don't know that you exist. Making sure that people use the right language. Now, the right language is something different. It's a cultural thing. What is appropriate, what is politically correct, and what is not politically correct is different. What's the attitude toward women? What's the attitude toward anyone that is different? You know, in our classes, one big issue is plagiarism. How do you make sure that people don't cheat? And it turned out that cheating is something that is culturally what considered to be cheating. Copying is not cheating in some cultures. So what we do is, first of all, when the students start, the first course is online strategies. Every student must take this course, and we teach them. We teach them what it means to study online, how do we expect you to study, how we expect you to behave, what is right and what is wrong. We make sure that you understand that politics is outside of the class, because otherwise, you know, it will be a big fight when you put people from so many countries. But it can be taught, and I think that after students realize, you know, what is right and what is wrong, and they start finding friends from different cultures, that's an amazing asset that we give them, and they know how to appreciate it. Yeah.
I mean, I would say it's interesting questions, because ultimately, although we are saying we are very different in our cultures, the aspirations and beliefs of these cultures are actually the same. People are always looking for progress. What has happened is before is that there is no network or platform that they could see what the real intent that every human being wants to come a day and start and getting progress. So two words have been very strong of late, whether you're marginalized or different cultures. And I can assure you, across the countries we work, there are as many cultures as anywhere else in the world. So, you know, with your networks and platforms, you are then able to build collaboration. And that's what was really lacking before. You know, whether you're Muslim or you're Christian, whether you're Hindu, it depends on where you are. Whether you went into your person with disabilities, or whether you're a young lady or a young boy, what do you get as a chance for you to progress in your own career, in your own education? And I think what we've seen in terms of the platform, and this generation of, especially now in the last 10 years, we are more interconnected than ever before in our history, actually. So we can be able to know what is happening. If someone else is down in Cape Town, they perhaps know exactly what is happening in San Francisco. Yeah, and now with the kind of information we have, it's easy to cross-share a common sense of purpose. And I think that, for me, gives us a new opportunity to leverage that collaborations to build a better sense of knowledge for every single person available in the system.
I agree with that. I'll sort of make two observations around that. One is, so for example, having done a lot of work with smallholder farmers in Ghana and other parts, there are certain advocacy policy things that are needed. So access to land rights, for example, access to financing. You know, those are things that you actually need some kind of systemic reform on to be able, right, to provide equal access in those things, right? You know, so if you set up an irrigation scheme, right, like why doesn't a female farmer get the same access as a male farmer to land on that scheme? Those things have to be addressed, and there's a sort of role for that to play. That's one. The second thing then is just following these examples of the farmers. The most powerful adoption mechanism and way of progress that I've seen is this demonstration, right? So if you are sort of disenfranchised, for you to do something different on your farm, the most powerful motivator is to see another farm that has done it and has gotten the results, as opposed to anyone telling you that this is the right thing to do. And that's where I sort of come back to the point you made on information. So So in a lot of these places, there are now SMS groups where you're a woman farmer, you can find out from another woman farmer on what, you know, what did they do to address this kind of disease? Where did they sell their crop? For what price? Where? And so there is this power of the network and information of the network in being able to do that. But I don't want to minimize this issue around what, you know, the kind of the systems policy advocacy work that also needs to be done, which can't just happen from a network and information play.
Talking for a second about what the internet enables us, it brings people to study that were unable to do so before. And whether it is in some cultures, as you all know, women are excluded from higher education and definitely higher education. Well, if they're studying online, they can do it from home without disrupting any social or cultural restrictions. They can study at home and become very productive members of their society. People, you know, in some cultures, mothers are not allowed to go back to universities after giving birth. They can study online. So you bring back these people or bring them to a place that they weren't able to do so. We have in our computer science, we teach only business administration and computer science, in our computer science classes, 50% more women than the average in the US. And the reason is because they can do that.
So let me dig a little bit deeper into the advocacy and policy piece, you know, of this question. And in terms of, Karan, you mentioned that, you know, there are some advocacy and policy pieces that need to take place globally or within certain countries, in fact, to make these opportunities more available. And within the work that, you know, each of you do, especially in the financial world and the education world, whether it be higher ed or otherwise, what do you think are some of the policies and advocacy pieces that need to happen in order to expand these opportunities for more people?
So I was giving just a real example on what we've done ourselves in the financial sector. And I think it's a really important piece, and Kenya has been privileged in terms of thinking a little bit beyond the current regulation and policy on accessing for credits and financial inclusion. And most of us here, I think, have heard very strongly about M-Pesa for years, in terms of providing mobile credits or mobile access to people who traditionally would not have access to any kind of resources or financial resources. So last year, actually, we did a partnership between KCB and M-Pesa in the market to basically build some mobile credit algorithms and blockchain information for any customers who we don't have to know today. And so regulators normally are very much against this policy of financial inclusions, where you are looking at someone's credit behavior, mobile money transfer, little savings that they have. And especially for women in Africa who don't have access to land rights, what this does is democratizes the space for themselves. And so those algorithms then gives you a kind of credit score, which is not linked to anyone owning any kind of assets. And this requires a policy change. And so Kenya's regulator has been able to be challenged to say, can you enable this kind of lending program? And after 1 year, actually, we had achieved 5 million people signing up to a mobile credit program with $100 million dispersed in 10 months. And what it does, when you look at the size of this kind of loan portfolio, it's around about $50 to $100 average, the loan size. And majority, 44% of the people using this facility are women with smaller businesses. The age profile is below the age of 35. And so you're starting to building an engine that provides, traditionally they will never qualify for this kind of information from working in a financial institution. And so the goal today is saying, how do we then provide this kind of platform and information across the region? And most regulators find this policy a little bit, you know, it's on the edge. So it's creating innovation or reimagining the platforms. How do we bring in easy access of services, especially financials, to people who never could have? And if you look at where the opportunities are, you know, in terms of businesses, open market systems. This is the area where they're going to find the businesses going forward. So I would say that we're seeing a lot of people saying, yes, we can attempt to do it, but a lot more needs to be done. You know, across 8 regulators in Africa we're working with, it's a question, should we go or should we not go? But my view is that nothing can stop the demand for customers who are ready for our solutions, not even regulation. And so there is a bigger task and challenge to work collaboratively with regulators across most markets. That's our experience in the financial sector.
In our case, I think that the issue of online learning, there are two separate things. There is the formal recognition and the perception. And the perception comes first. Because when I announced the university, the reaction was no tuition-free university can exist without the support of a government. So we said, okay, and we show that it does exist. Then people say it will never be accredited. Now it is accredited, people say it will never be sustainable. Well, it will be sustainable in a couple of months. But the perception is that online learning is not legitimate, definitely academic online learning, and if it is, the quality is not there. So we have great professors, presidents of the best universities of the world, volunteering with us, you know, Oxford, NYU, Berkeley, etc. We have a partnership with NYU where our students can continue their studies with NYU. We just actually earlier this week, 2 weeks, 2 days ago, we announced that our associate degree graduate can continue toward their bachelor with Berkeley. Obviously, the quality is there, right? If Berkeley checked our standards and decided it's good enough for Berkeley, maybe it's not good enough for everyone, but at least it's good enough for Berkeley. So, but still, people doubt it. So you need to convince people. And it happened because it's new, because there were a lot of players that did not deliver, but it takes time until the perception is there. So we need to have a lot of graduates finding jobs in great places to show that it really works. For the perception. Then come the governments. And usually governments follow what people think. We need to find really strong leaders who will check and will say, I'm going to have a stand there and push forward. Because when you think about it, what we build with University of the People is a model. It's a model to show, first of all, universities that instead of having 10,000 students, they can add 0 to their numbers and open the gate to 100,000 students, but even more so to developing countries' governments. Because right now, those governments take the few millions that they have and they build their Harvard, Stanford, Oxford, right? A few years go by and it's not, because you don't build these institutions in a few years and neither with a few millions, but the money is gone. And what we said, use the internet in order to educate every single person in your country with the same amount of money. And think about what a great leap it will be for your country if every qualified student will end up with a quality education and a degree. But you know, leaders need to take a stand. And we haven't found so far the leader who would come and say, I'll do it for my country. It will happen, it's a matter of time, but how do you expedite it? That's a different question.
A few thoughts on that. One is there are policy things you can do to think about how, again, you people invest more in human capital. So, for example, today the way some of the tax treatments work. And the way some of the sort of businesses have to sort of report earnings, it does skew the world towards more and more automation. In that, you know, if you invested in something, you would, you know, depreciate it over 5 years. It would go on the balance sheet, right? As opposed to if you spent money 6 months training someone, right, to do it. So there are, you know, some of those things. There are things around how you do financing of talent that's pay for success. Or financing of learning that is more pay for success around outcomes than what it is today. But I agree with Shai that I think this is gonna come from showcasing the innovation. It's going to come, in my view, from communities, entrepreneurs, businesses, other institutions, proving a model, irrespective of sort of what the circumstances there, and then demonstrating the impact of that. That then gets the attention of policymakers on how to do it. And I think there's another important role to play, which is sort of less policy, but think, and this is, I think, some of the role of philanthropy here is, who can play the best role for collective action and for data and information sharing? So if I am a training program, if I want to set up a training program today, whether it's here or anywhere in the world, what do I have to do? I have to go and recruit job seekers, right? You know, students who I want to help serve. I have to do training really well. And then I also have to go and find individual employers who will hire those students. I have to do the whole stack. And every next program has to do the whole stack themselves. So imagine you had to build a phone and you had to go source the components and build a retail store to sell it and all of that. It's extremely hard. So now if you said, okay, there is a training program that has 2,000 employers in it, 3,000 employers, whose role is it that can say the convening of, look, here are the employers, here's the skills they're willing to hire for, and how do you make that information, and here are trusted ways that if you demonstrate that you can do this, they would hire, and make that information available. So now as a training provider, whether I'm online, whether I'm offline, whether I'm blended, whatever it is, my goal is on doing the best training that is possible and to plug into this, and then you unleash more and more innovation in the space. So what is the role of collective action in this, and who is best placed to do it? And oftentimes it is either governments or civic institutions that are leaders in those spaces, not individual businesses or social entrepreneurs. They just don't have the capacity, the social capital, or the incentive to be able to do it.
We've talked about a lot of different sectors here, and one of the ones we actually haven't touched on but is so critical to this work going forward are the businesses and industries, and that they're going to have to be a huge part of figuring out where these jobs are coming from and producing them. And thinking about it within the context of the work that you're doing, what do you think we need to do to engage those big businesses and those entrepreneurs that are not just at the micro level, but at the macro level too?
So I would say for where we see real opportunity for creating jobs and assignment, this really skilling for self-employment and small and medium enterprises. I mean, you talk about large businesses, but I believe that we must be very deliberate ourselves in the markets. Where we are, we see out of new opportunities coming for jobs, 9 out of 10 is coming from what you call traditionally informal businesses. These are micro and small, very agile, very dynamic. So even in terms of skilling and providing resources, we have to be very deliberate in how do we build those teams. And they can't do it by themselves. I mean, under the foundations, I'm with Jane here, who sits in our foundation as a director, we set up a program to build up smaller businesses, 100,000 smaller businesses in the next 5 years. And this is really young startups, you know, part of building their own skills, upskilling them, you know, networking them, incubating the businesses from a foundation, from a philanthropy arm, and say, can we network and connect you into the marketplace? I think that nuance must be driven, because in that way, we are formalizing a sector that perhaps is as significant, driving up to 40% or 45% of the GDP for most of the African countries, and then making them in a way that is formal to create the opportunity for growth. So there has to be a way of interconnecting both the large and the small enterprises, and a lot of philanthropy has to come in to support in that aspect of growth and the momentum for the jobs.
So on this, through our work on Tech Hire, which is an initiative here, we've got now 900-plus employers who've signed up to say they're willing to hire based on ability, not pedigree, for IT roles. And IT roles are all across, right? Only a third, so two-thirds of the IT jobs are not in the tech sector. Think healthcare, think banking, think insurance. In those places, everybody has IT needs. There are 700,000 open jobs. So, but why are they coming to the table? So the question of sort of big businesses, yes, they have a role to play, all that. So why are they doing? They're doing it because they have an incentive. The incentive is that their time to hire has gone up significantly over the last 5 years. Their cost to hire has gone up for talent. There are, you know, 5 million open jobs right now that they're struggling to fill as businesses, 700,000 of those in IT. So we're seeing they're coming to the table. They're coming to the table, but to Joshua's point, the power is in them coming to the table together. Because each one individually cannot, you know, is not willing to change their practices, do whatever, if the market is not going to move in the same way. And so it comes back to how do you actually mobilize them? And here, who are the people in the communities who are the leaders? In some places, it's an employer, right, in Kenya, that you are leading the way and bringing other employers together. In some places, it's a council. In some places, it's an industry association. In some places, it's the governor or the sort of the leader. In some places, it's a civic institution that's doing it. So where are the nodes in the network that can aggregate these employers? And then what's the incentive for them to stay at the table?
I think that in the world of higher education, there should be closer connection between the universities and the job market. I think that it's very nice to criticize higher education, but the big companies are not part of higher education, and they should be. You know, when we set up the university, we decided that each program, and we teach business administration, computer science, and soon health science, we will have advisory board, and the advisory board will have the combination of academics and practitioners, people from the corporate. So they will decide together what are the right courses to teach the students and what they need in order to be prepared for the job market. Moreover, I think that every student in any university should have the opportunity for internship, to experience what the real world is. I think that it's a good idea to have mentors. In our case, we have mentors to our students from the corporate world as well. So you want to bring them closer. Instead of criticizing higher education, change the higher education to make it more fit to the needs of the 21st century world.
Right. But make it easy. Hmm? Make it easy for employers and for businesses, because you know the businesses don't make decisions sitting around, you know, in 30, 40 person tables talking about collaboration. If you want mentors from them, make it easy on how they can plug into it. If you want them to change some of their HR practices, what are their existing systems? Go deep, three levels down. This is the screening software they're using. This is the proxy they're using. How do I plug someone in that is low risk for them and easy for them to do it? Because expecting businesses also to fundamentally change the way they're operating today, we're not going to get very far doing that.
Great. So we're going to open it up for Q&A from the audience. And I think there are staff around the room who have microphones. So please raise your hands, and they'll come around the room with microphone. And in the meantime, I'd like the panelists to take a few minutes to think about a question that I'd like you to answer at the end of this is, you have a room full of philanthropists here. What is one priority thing that you think they should support in the coming years? Questions from the audience? Here we go. And please say who you are and where you're from.
Good morning. My name is Erna Gross, and I'm the CEO of Asante Africa Foundation, focused in East Africa at the educational level, sort of one step below getting ready for the job market. And as we know, there is this flood of youth with pent-up energy and hunger and tenacity and I can do anything, but they don't know how to do it. So my question for you is, bringing it down to the secondary level, what are the critical skill sets that you think these youth need to be learning in the academic as well as soft skills to get them ready for the next step beyond the classroom?
At that level, so in the work that I've done with the sort of venture in Nigeria, which focuses a lot on youth and in frontline entry-level jobs, particularly retail and hospitality, which is a huge private sector employer of those jobs. So think waiter, waitress, front desk staff. If you go into a mall, right, the person who greets you at a store, think those jobs, and the skills that matter for that are oftentimes soft skills. So it's critical thinking. It is, and then in those customer service roles, for example, right, then you have to break it down and say, actually, it's things like conflict resolution, it's things like professionalism. Because the youth that we work with, they have the innate potential. I mean, think, somebody hustling on the street, selling phone credit, selling whatever to you at a stoplight, that person knows how to sell. You put them in a store, they can sell. But what they need is sort of the professionalism. You have to show up at 9, you know, this, and you have to show up in this way. Critical thinking of sort of how you problem solve things, expectations management of how you work, because they've not worked in the formal sector before. The things that I or you or anyone here learned on their first job, whether that was at a fast food restaurant or whatever, they're things that you learned in being in a formal place, in an internship or whatever it was, that you sort of have to provide pretty quickly. So at that level, it is those sort of critical thinking, professionalism skills that we're finding are useful. Now, if you go into net vocations, of course, you need the hard skill component to it, whether it's IT, construction, whatever it is.
I think I would just add one more area for me. The young people, and it's a really dramatic, the shift in terms of the people coming on the marketplace in Africa today. I mean, it's a tipping point, actually, if you look at it in that way. So entrepreneurial skills, a lot of them are much more focused on starting up a business. This is what I see more and more than even looking for a formal job. So and I may call them hustlers, but when you call about hustling in the context of the word, these are the real small startups. So I would say that there's going to be a little bit more bias. You know, some of the areas we see them focusing on hospitality, you know, beauty services, we see motor, it's a lot of motor, it could be second-hand cars, agribusinesses. We see that as an area that we can focus on. So because they will build entrepreneur, they're actually able, strange enough, to hire part of their network to come and do work for themselves. This is a different kind of way of looking at the objective or the challenge at hand, that they could be able to drive their smaller businesses because of being entrepreneurs and hire the skills that they can get for students coming out of a normal school. So I wouldn't say that the younger people may necessarily have to go in and get the final education, but if they are clear that they are able to run a business, they will for sure get people to do work for them to build that business. That is what you're trying to do in our Tujiajiri program, targeting 100,000 of them. And when they're younger, out of 21, 22, out of high school actually, they're saying, I'm gonna start up my own business. And sometimes they build very credible and strong businesses. So I will go back and say build entrepreneurial skills for them. And also that will be a basis. They're very networked in our view. We find that they are already networked than you can ever believe. Sometimes they're already in their Instagram, in their Twitter, in their Facebook, already selling their products or their networks already in that marketplace.
So I can just add, I agree to every word, and I can just add that whatever you teach them, just make sure that you don't kill their enthusiasm and their creativity. That's the most important thing.
And I would just add to the course, Mozilla just launched a web literacy map last week, and we intentionally actually included 21st century skills as part of that effort. So if you're going to learn to read, write, and participate on the web, you're going to learn 21st century skills of collaboration, communication, problem solving, and critical thinking, all as part of the web literacy map. So I encourage you to take a look at that, because we're also looking at credentials as part of that effort too. Other questions?
Steve Alderman with the Peter C. Alderman Foundation. We work in Africa and Southeast Asia, and as a result of that, we have a large experience with youth that have been traumatized. The World Bank talks about non-cognitive skills, which are emotional regulation, coming in on time, taking criticism, learning how to work as teams. If you gentlemen are talking about educating a population, okay, 50% of traumatized youth okay, or that have traumatizing factors in their history, grinding poverty, gender-based violence, war itself, ethnic cleansing, what have you. They've got problems that you can't get critical thinking until you get thinking. Okay, and I'm wondering, do you have any approach that to this class of people? Thank you.
I'm not sure that we do. You know, UNESCO stated that in 2025 there will be 100 million students in the world that will not have seats in the existing universities. We believe that we build a model to accommodate them. Does it fit everyone? No. Even, you know, you don't need to be traumatized in order to find it very hard to study online. And it's hard, it's not for everyone. We have a lot of students who cannot make it. But we are the opportunity for those who have no other opportunity. So take, for example, we announced a project where we're taking 500 refugees, Syrian, mainly Syrian refugees, to study with us. To my knowledge, we are no university were committed to take 500 Syrian students. Can they study with us? Well, so far we have 1,500 of them who applied, and it's in English. It's hard for them. Can they make it? We'll see, because life is on the way for many of them, for many of our students in general. They do whatever they can. Sometimes they can't do it. So I don't think that there is one answer fits all. I think that what we do fits most of the people, not all of them.
And I think so then in those instances, in my view, it's not one answer fits all, but it's the what is the collection of things, and then what's the ladder that you need. So so in that, again, sort of working rural poor, for example, that I've done a lot of work with, there are some things that we could do with training, but then there are a set of other support services that they need. Right, what is your backstop if there's a disaster? What, you know, and so it's more what is the coordination of the services you need, and where does something that is in learning like this plug into that, as opposed to be the silver bullet of what it takes? Because there are things that can be done efficiently with what Shai is talking about, what Joshua was talking about, but there are a lot of things that have to happen offline, locally, in that community, and a set of support services that you need to do it.
In the last couple minutes that we have, I want to come back to the question that I raised earlier, which is you have a room full of philanthropists, and if you had one ask of what they should prioritize in terms of their funding, what would you like to ask?
I will call it, I'll cheat a little bit and give you a broad bucket so you can pick and choose in that what you want. But what we call infrastructure for inclusion, and that's not hard infrastructure. I mean, who is going to do to tackle this collective action problem I talked about? Who is going to provide the data and the information that, again, many, many people, higher education institutions, training providers, whoever can fit into, right? Who is going to then also do the risk capital for innovation, new things we do? This, in my view, I mean, philanthropy is the highest risk-seeking capital form. And so those, to me, are system things. So in the work you do, I would address, if you're trying to solve something, are you funding a program, or are you funding something that can be systemic change? And if it's something that's systemic change, if you break it down, what market failure are you trying to solve? And that, to me, is what philanthropy should be thinking about. Because ultimately, businesses won't do it on their own, and private capital markets are unable to do it.
I mean, I would say it's quite exciting for me just sitting here and listening the last 3 days. But I would say two things. I mean, we're sitting in an area where dramatically, you can create exponential change in the markets where we are on the informal sector. And this is really an area I see a lot of philanthropy work going on. And what you're looking for, in my view, is building much more collaborations with institutions that are more about focusing process change and being catalyst. So across most Africa, you know, listening at us in Tanzania, whether you are in Ghana, whether you are in Mozambique, I think there is an area that if you're going to unveil and address the gap that we see on the younger population joining the workforce in the next, this year and the next 5 years, I think I'd like to ask for much more collaborations to institutions that are already driving the systemic change. That for me would be my big ask, because there is already a network of few. It's to find those and plug in to kind of turn the tide and maybe accelerate the transformation already happening on the informal sector.
Two things. First, and I want again to talk about the Syrian refugee crisis, which talked about a lot this in this conference. You know, their survival is paramount. It's extremely important. The shelter, the food, the health, their immediate needs must be a priority. But I would expect people to think about their future. You don't want to feed them forever. You don't want them to be unemployed and be dependent on donations for their entire life. So think about what will enable them to become productive members of the societies where they live, or even if they, even better, if they ever go back, what will enable them to rebuild their countries? So this is one thing. Think about the long term, not only the short term. I think that the second thing is look at initiatives that are coming to your hands that might change the world. Things that might have huge effect or large effect on how we live, how people live, or industries, different industries. So I think that philanthropists are the best people to take risks and to show things that can work large scale in the future. And I think that that's their major role.
Great. Thank you all. And I just want to thank you all for the great work that you've done, the great work you're going to continue to do, and being on this panel. Let's all give these guys a great hand of applause.